I think mainly Reagan was like, oh my God, there's a movie star as president. He seems borderline senile. Apparently they're doing like seances and astrology in the White House. And it just seemed like, you know, more comedy really.
I gotta mug you.
Is that gorgeous or what, eh?
And I believe I can run a decent marathon.
Thank you very much.
Download Veely now.
You know, we woke up when most people almost went to bed. You know, our days back then started at 6, 7 o'clock.
It was like the 80s on 11.
People in the scene were more ready and willing to kind of check out the other side. I mean, I was thinking about it, if you roll the clock back that 5 years earlier when I was in 45 Grave, and some of those bands, the twain didn't meet. Like you had your punk clubs, everyone went to see the punk band. And you had Motley Crue and Wasp down at the Troubadour, what have you. And there were people that went to both of those shows, but you usually didn't see bands from one or the other on the same bill.
The 80s LA thing was all about you know, it's like all the guitar players are Van Halen influenced, and you know, it was all that lily jump. And posing and all that, you know, and we came from the 70s. So you know, it was more like you said, AC/DC. One night in the clubs, I was shaking hands. Ramones. Especially, you know, being the East Coast, and the Ramones had that touring thing where they just get in the van and go, and that was our philosophy too.
And there was, you know, it was so much of that dance, that mating dance that people were into, but with the backdrop of this cool style and, you know, a kind of changing type of music. It was bands like The Cult. It became bands like Guns N' Roses. It was, you know, it was a much more rock and roll kind of atmosphere than the punk rock atmosphere that I had come from and that I was evolving out of.
Wanted to get, you know, like a punk band thing going, and one day I was at a friend's house and we were smoking some weed, and this is down in Newport Beach, and had K-Rock on the radio, and this is early, this is like 81 maybe, and they played this song by a band called Wire called, the song is called A Touching Display. And before I heard this song, I was into like Elvis Costello, you know, the B-52s and bands like that. And this song completely changed my life direction.
You know, coming from Pennsylvania, where you had all this like crappy metal. Just was stupid, you know. It just meant nothing to me, you know.
Well, I grew up in the punk scene starting in 1979. Yeah, very young, hitchhiking to Hollywood, going to the Vex and like Godzilla's, and I just always remember when I'd walk onto my high school campus that I wasn't like all these people. I knew there was something wrong with me.
it all just like sort of went hand in hand, you know, the music scene, the fashion scene, the shopping scene, the even the movie scene.
I went to school in Spokane, Washington, and I was like the only rock and roll guy there that looked like me. By that I mean the only rock and roll guy trying to look like Johnny Thunders. And I thought, all right, I'm cool. I look like Johnny Thunders. I got black hair. I'm going to go to L.A. and take the place by storm. So I get to Los Angeles, and I'm looking around, and I see all these rockers, and they all look just like me. They're all trying to look like Johnny Thunders. I was like, oh, no, I'm nobody here. This is terrible.
Totally different. It was just totally different thing than what it ended up becoming to, like, everybody else. But at that time, we're like, gothic. And it's like kind of sleazy, kind of gypsy looking. I mean, you look at, I mean, it was cool, you know what I mean? But the hair metal thing was like totally, became kind of too pretty and everybody started doing it and everybody kind of looked the same.
We're up in New York. I'm from Borough, Queens. Same, went to the same high school as three of the New York Dolls. What you got, and that ain't all you got. You got personality. Sylvain, Johnny Thunders, and Arthur King. And I also stumbled upon the Ramones when they were still just a local club band playing at this club called the Coventry on Queens Boulevard. Let's go! And so that's what kind of got me into the underground rock and roll scene.
I was a total freak in high school, and I hung out in downtown Houston where all the freaks kind of gravitated to, you know, the gay scene and the new wave scene, and the punks were all downtown. There were a lot of people getting beat up because Houston was a pretty conservative city. And I came out to LA, and all of a sudden there were people like me, and even more extreme than me. And I thought I was pretty extreme because I had a mohawk.
It was a nice community where everyone supported each other, whether they were designing rock and roll clothes, playing in a rock and roll band, you know, dating a rock and roller, starting a rock and roll club, trying to manage a rock and roll band. Everyone respected what each other was trying to do.
I wanted to see the bands that I was dancing to at the clubs.
D-Car really decided, we saw kind of the writing on the wall, and me and Todd had talked about this, and we were like, when did D-Car kind of switch from being, you know, a Southern California version of the Dead Boys? To being a wannabe Southern California version of Hanoi Rock. With the Dead Boys mixed in, and you know, all of a sudden we discovered Metallica.
We went and played the closing night at Cafe de Grand. It went over really well. It was like a real weird mix of people, some with mohawks, some with like long hair. You know, cross between punk and what was starting to become the glam scene.
It's really funny when I read things about the drum. There's always commentary that Darby always had these little girls from Beverly Hills High School front row in the audience, and I laughed because that was us. Me and two of my friends, we thought we were punk rock. We weren't. We were really lame, but those are the shows that we started going to.
I just wanted to be out there and just, you know, be a rock and roller, you know. I started off as a punk rocker years ago, and it kind of just evolved. It went from, like, punk rock. Into new wave. And then I went to the pop rock route. because when it started going into more of like the metal or that kind of route, or like let's say the Poison route. Doctor, it's me. That wasn't really for me because that time it was very much like objectifying women, and I was really like all about girl power, and I wanted to keep my girl power alive.
Just came up for a weekend, did a scam at the Palladium. We went up to the list and just looked at the list and was like, okay, you're this person, I'm this person, and got one that had like 10 plus. We just looked for the biggest number next to it. And it was like a 10, so it was Metallica at the Palladium. It was sold out, and we had 10 tickets and passes and just sold them off. And then that weekend, I found a free place to live with some chicks. Actually, it's just a couple blocks down the street, too, so it was pretty interesting. I've been in L.A. ever since.
We had a radio show on K-Rock called The Import Show, and once a week we would bring the 10 best import singles and give them to the station to play during the week. We'd play it once and then we'd leave it with them. Whether they played it afterwards or not, who knows? But we played Depeche Mode. It's a competitive world. Everything counts in large amounts. Oh, Culture Club. Bauhaus. For the first time in America, and first time in California, let's put it that way.
It seemed like there was a lot of people that at first blush you wouldn't think would get along, but as long as someone believed in your level of sincerity, you're cool, man. Black, white, striped, straight, gay, you know, fast ska, punk rock, hard rock. I mean, I've seen more gatherings of people that you would never think would be hanging out together.
And I got a fake ID when I was 17. And so I started going to all the shows around town. And man, it was just a great scene. There were thousands of kids in the scene. And every night you would go to these clubs and there were just thousands of kids into rock and roll.
I felt personally was missing from a lot of the more like dude-centric glam bands of the mid-80s. The Celebrity Skin got out. Completely gay and like hilarious the New York Dolls was. Whereas my impression of a lot of those other bands, like the Poison, this is just my impression, was that they completely missed the humor and the fagginess of it. And they took this like super dude stance that I was like, that's not the point, you know? And so to me, Celebrity Skin really captured that.
The reason why, like you said, you can put Jane's Addiction, Guns N' Roses, Junkyard. Human Drama. These bands, you can put them all on the same bill and it would make sense. And it just would make sense because I guess everybody was really born out of the same womb. Everybody was born out of east of La Cienega.
Yeah, we were just trying to be sort of a rock and roll band without not heavy metal, you know, no screaming vocals. Long guitar solos, or you know, just that the tourists, these sort of valley musicians coming from the valley with their fur boots and stuff and way too much makeup.
There was a huge influx of these, what we called the gypsy junkie bands. You know, they'd have like tight leather stuff that was real ratty, and they'd have bandanas everywhere, and their scarves all over the place. It was like a nation of Steven Tyler, Keith Richardses, you know, and it got to be really like the reigning paradigm.
It wasn't until the 80s when everybody started having a problem with gay people being in rock and roll. That's why I always loved bands like Love Dog, because they also had gay members, but also they were women, and the Pandoras, and L7, and those bands, because they once again were like bucking that whole thing that, like, you're not allowed to do this. This is only for straight white males. No one else is allowed here.
But that was kind of an interesting part, I think, of that time, was that bands were just combining things that normally wouldn't have gone together and getting away with it. And like, when I think back on where we played and the bands we played with, it was a pretty, it was bands that would not normally play together today. Like, we shared bills with Bane's Addiction. Jet Boy. A Motorcycle Boy. Play LA Guns. When you, if you thought of those bands on a festival today, you'd probably have a gun in your hand. I mean, it just wouldn't happen.
Bands formed organically back then, because you'd see, you know, you'd be in a room, Guns N' Roses was playing, or, you know, whoever, Texan Horseheads or Horseheads, and you know, TSOL or whoever was playing at the gig, you'd be there, and there would be like-minded people watching the show in the crowd, and invariably, you know, that's how guys would be like, hey man, you play an instrument? You know, we're looking for a bass player or whatever it is. And, you know, guys would split off into different factions. And then you'd end up with some guys being in for, you know, keeping going around in different arrangements of the same guys in different bands. And, but again, it all came from the social interaction.
That's what I really thought was the last gasp of the original LA punk scene, when Guns N' Roses and Jane's Addiction were both coming up at the same time.
With Guns N' Roses was they weren't like total glam. They were more of the sleazy, you know, the Stonesy kind of like gritty. It wasn't the pretty boy kind of thing, which appealed to me.
That's right. The first time I saw Guns N' Roses, actually, the kick, I was just like, whoa, these guys were. I went with Tammy. I just met Tammy, and we went there, and they were just unbelievable. That place was so packed, and they were just so good. And Tammy used to work there. He did like lights there when we first started.
Oh, we formed a band. I'm like, congratulations, what's it called? He said, Guns N' Roses. I said, well, what are you playing? Of course I want to come. And at that time, Tammy was running the spotlight at the Troubadour and working at Retail Slot. And Bruce was working at Retail Slot. So there was a big scene, and we all were friends, and it was great. And so Guns N' Roses had just started, and I went and saw their first few shows, and I thought they were amazing. I said, give me a tape, because I want to play it on the radio. And they were like, oh my God, that's so great. So I played it on K-Rock, and then I took that tape, and I shopped it around to different record labels.
Axel and Izzy jumped on stage with us while we were playing, uninvited, of course. And I forget, we were doing like an encore of like Jumpin' Jack Flash or something, and those guys jumped out of the crowd and started singing along uninvited. I thought that was really sort of cheeky, you know, sort of rude.
Played there with Guns N' Roses, I think, but they didn't show up. We played there with their name.
Slash was so drunk before he even got into the club. It was like unbelievable. He was falling down and he would lock himself in my band's van. And I don't know, I think at the time he like liked me or something. And he was like so drunk, like beyond drunk. And he'd be like, you're never going to go out with me. And just like, I don't even know if you can see me. You're so drunk, you know? So, but we would have to like push him out of the van, the like the loved one's van. And it was hilarious. And it's, you know, it's sad for me because I never got to actually know Slash or Perry because of the drunkenness and the weirdness, you know, but I really appreciated, you know, how talented they were. And it's amazing.
I saw them 5 or 6 times, and every time I saw them, they were better than the last. The first time I saw them was at the Music Machine, and there was no vibe. And they were sort of, I think they'd won the Music Connection Band of the Year. And I was like, who are these guys? They weren't part of my clique, you know? And I was like, why are these guys so automatic hatred? And then I saw them, and it was just like, I don't get this at all. Then I saw them at the Scream, and I was like, okay, I get it.
And I kept on hearing about this band. There, my friends were like, you know, you gotta come to the Scream and check these guys out. And it was like going and seeing Led Zeppelin for the first time, man. There was nothing like it. I mean, it was so organic and tribal. I mean, it was just like, I mean, the guitars were screaming, but then it had this kind of arty kind of ambiance to it. You know, it was really original.
So to come to LA that first night and to hear Jane's Addiction, and it was just everything I ever wanted to be was in that record. It was frightening, it was scary, it was like the Stones in that sense that it was frightening, but it had some, he had something to say, like the shit he was saying was like, it was the opposite of Poison, you know? So it made me so excited, and to this day, I'm just the biggest fan, you know? And it holds up, you hear that stuff, it still scares the fuck out of me when I hear it. I'm like, they're gonna take over a small country, this music.
So these guys were working it, man. They had a sound that was made for these enormous halls. They were super slow, they had shit tons of echo on everything anyway. So it just sounded normal. There'd be these other bands they'd see playing at these places, and they all just sounded like crap because of the rooms. And then Jane's Addiction would come on, and glory, hallelujah, it was the most incredible thing ever in its element, too. It was like the perfect place to see Jane's Addiction.
They were sort of the house band at Scream. That's how I think of them in the early days. I mean, for real. I mean, you know, that's where they got their footing. I mean, Perry was in a band before that, Psycom, and the people that were in Psycom were good friends of mine. They made a fanzine that we used to carry and sell at Vinyl Fetters called Contagion. And Perry was in that band with these people. And then I knew him from that. And then after that, he did Jane's Addiction. And I was DJing at Scream, but at Scream, there were multiple rooms. So the room that I was in was not the room that the bands were performing in. So I'd have to put on a long record or some take a break and run and see bands. So I didn't see everybody that played at Scream because of that.
When I first got into music at like age 13 or whatnot, and you know, it was like Led Zeppelin and Van Halen and oh God, Journey, that's embarrassing. UFO, all those bands. And then when I came back and was hanging out with Perry and Jane's Addiction, it was almost like, well, there was the revitalization, revisitation of Led Zeppelin. And Jane's Addiction definitely had a Led Zeppelin influence. And I can always remember like Dave Navarro playing Over the Bridge and Far Away, and I'd be like, oh, that brought me back. And, you know, there when I got into punk rock, it wasn't cool to still like Led Zeppelin. But then here we go, flash forward, you know, 5 years later, it was like, oh, Zepp again. Oh, we're back.
I remember Perry Farrell was handing out popcorn to everyone. He had bags of popcorn, and he was just like, here, have some popcorn. And we were kind of afraid of Perry then because he was so weird, and we're like, this popcorn's laced, okay? There's no way I'm eating this popcorn. But his band was incredible.
Jane's Addiction, Cold September, Damn Yankees in the main room, and then we put Dale in the annex room down the street with a big trash can full of alcohol punch we made. So, I mean, it was underground. They didn't really have alcohol, so you could dance in her room and drink, you know, for like $3 a cup or whatever, this horrible alcohol punch, and then see the bands in the room that I was DJing in, and it was really weird and kind of seedy, but the bands were great, as far as I know. They had a great time. That was our first exposure to Jane's Addiction. He came out in a shopping cart with some nylons on, completely naked, and the exact words are slipping my mind right now, but something like, I came here for two reasons, one to rock out and one to show my cock off, and he proceeded to fucking tear the place down in his nylons with his cock out. It was awesome.
That's what I thought, where the LA scene, the last two great, great bands from the LA scene that I saw was Jane's Addiction and Guns N' Roses coming up at the same time. Yeah. And they were the parallels, and Jane's Addiction was absolutely in the tradition of the old punk bands, because Jane's Addiction shouldn't have gotten big. They were really great, but they were too weird.
The scene then was so vibrant. It was like every night we went out somewhere. Every night there was something going on in LA. You know, you just felt like you were really part of something that was exciting. And I think every single person just, you know, lived for the night, just to be able to, like, you know, stay, get through their day and then stay up all night and go to these clubs.
I feel like when we first started playing, those places didn't exist yet. You know, it was more like the Gaslight. You know, we'd play at the Gaslight or Raji's, or the Lingerie was still there. And then there started to become this kind of like more club scene that had live bands. You know, before that, I felt like, at least in my memory, which could be inaccurate, that the club stuff was more that kind of like fetish or like stuff that didn't really have live bands as much.
I feel really fortunate to have had it, because I don't remember. New York was like that as well, but that time period, I don't remember another time in my musical life where you could go out every night of the week and it was jam-packed everywhere you went. People wanted to go out and interact and see bands and be part of something. And it's not, I haven't seen that as much.
We started a club called TVC15 because Henry was doing Glam Slam at the time. And I sort of saw this, we both saw this sort of this merging of looks and fashion. So you'd see these guys from Love and Rockets and Daniel Ash and these people, if you stood them next to Nikki Sixx, you couldn't tell them apart. They dressed the same. It was sort of the same kind of thing. The big rotted out hair. It was all, you know, a Johnny Thunders kind of knockoff, but which was a Keith Richards knockoff. So if you want to keep, you know, continue down the line. But that's sort of where we thought things were going.
It was more of a club scene. It was more of like a dance club scene, which had been going on a little bit prior to my leaving, but the Glam Slam and now Power Tools and the one that I'm not remembering, all those clubs were very popular. So it wasn't necessarily bands, because there had been the big punk rock wave, and then it was sort of changing and becoming like rock and roll discos.
It seemed like the scene was coming off of punk rock a little bit, and LA was more of kind of a hardcore punk rock scene, and it was getting into this kind of glam, almost like a metal. Aerosmith was really big. Hanoi rock. It was all starting to mix together, so it was like punk and glam and goth, and it was Everybody was dressing in black, but there was like these gypsy scarves and big hair and cowboy boots and concho belts. So it was all kind of mixing together, but it all worked.
Scream was LA's largest alternative nightclub in the mid to late 80s. It was a catalyst for a new musical era that brought the attention back to Los Angeles. What set Scream apart from all the other clubs was its ability to draw from all the scenes and cross all genres. It was a true musical melting pot, and it was 18 and over. The club's concept was to give as much entertainment as possible. On any given night at Scream, there were multiple floors, band video and dance rooms, dangerous stairways, patios, unisex bathrooms, 3D blacklight art installations, and horror projections were everywhere. It was a forerunner to the Lollapalooza movement of the 90s. At Scream, great local, national, and world touring acts played on the same bill. Some of the most adventurous, dark, and dangerous bands of the day called it home. Jane's Addiction was even considered Scream's house band. Some other notables to play Scream were Iggy Pop, Johnny Thunders, The Cult, Guns N' Roses, The Sugar Cubes, Red Hot Chili Peppers, Soundgarden, Ministry, Bad Religion, Faith No More, Sonic Youth, Nick Cave, Mission UK, Specimen, X, Christian Death, Wolfgang Press, Revolting Cox, Lords of the New Church, Fishbone, and White Zombie, just to name a few.
The Scream to me was always like a bigger, small club.
And you'd go into the bathroom and it'd just be like, psh, everybody was just hairspraying like crazy. And I can't believe we all aren't, you know, having horrible illnesses from all the Aquanet and cigarette smoke that we inhaled.
You would get people from the rock and roll scene or like the punk and rock scene hanging out with more of like the dance club scene.
The best part about Scream, I think, was when we had bands that weren't from LA. I think even when there was Chili Peppers playing, I think the people that I worked with at the club, they were more excited when a band came from the East Coast or from England, like The Mission at the time and Lords of the New Church, just because we didn't get a lot of that. Those other bands like Chili Peppers, Jane's Addiction, they were playing everywhere in LA.
They would play music that I could actually relate to, whereas the music that other people were listening to, you know, wasn't hitting home for me. It just, we were dancing to like Bowie. Oh! T-Rex. Susie and the Banshees. I just thought, oh my God, you know, finally a scene that people can, I can relate to.
Well, the Scream was always where the girls that were just sort of out of reach for me, it seemed, were there, and like people running around in their black bras. It was almost like a torture chamber in some ways. I felt like I will never be this cool, but yet, what do you know, they let me in and here I am.
So we ended up at the Embassy Hotel, which was, oh my God, that place was wonderful. It was like a three-story Death Rock Disneyland. There was just so much stuff in there. And it was just like, you know, the layout was what we call the descent into hell. This stairway that went with black stairs going down with no lights, and people would come, I mean, nobody broke their necks ever on that thing. Nobody. And you were just plunged into darkness, and from there you'd go into this room, which was where the bands were, which they decided to save the carpet by covering it all with black plastic. And after a few drinks are spilled and you're drunk, you're just, it's like playing Gothic Twister.
It was a lot of big hair, like huge poofy hair, lots of makeup, lots of death rock makeup. And we used to theorize, they called the club the Scream because that's what you would do when you woke up in the morning and saw that beautiful girl that you dragged home from there the night before and what she really looked like.
When I went to Scream and it had, you know, there was such a blending of styles at that point, right? I mean, there was punk and there was, but it was heavy too. And you could be, you know, there was a lot of different bands with a lot of, that you could hear all the influences for. And it was very diverse and I thought, man, this is cool. And so I kind of got back into the scene and Love Razors was kind of a part of that.
It was controlled chaos. Like, it was always seemed like it was right on the verge of something exploding or breaking down, you know?
That was the thing that was cool about that scene, because there's so many, there's Jane's Addiction, you had Fishbone,
You had GNR and our kind of scene, but everybody kind of played the same. Like, you could see all kinds of bands in one night at the Screen.
Red Hot Chili Peppers was one of our biggest shows, because at the time that we opened for them, we had a pretty cool following. So that was just absolutely insane. The Chili Peppers were great. We played with Specimen, Jane's Addiction, and Community FK, who I always thought were really, really underrated.
It was the most vibey, the greatest place to play, and did the most for us in terms of, like, you know, getting us closer to being where we wanted to be.
This was a time when music, you know, especially on the Sunset Strip, they were really doing this pay-to-play thing. So if you wanted to have a gig at a show, a place like the Whiskey, you would basically have to get people to come and to sign up for it pretty much ahead of time to be able to have your gig. And he was really against the whole pay-to-play thing. And so he started putting on his own shows at different warehouses and whatnot. And then the Screen Club came into play, and they started playing there and really liked him. And basically, Jane's Addiction became like the house band.
That was pretty powerful, seeing those shows, because there wasn't fancy lighting. There wasn't fancy stage. It was a bare bones vacant building that they basically took over, and you're watching these bands play and drinking some warm beer in a plastic cup.
Scream was more of a cocaine acid club. It seemed like everyone was always tripping on acid, or everyone was doing cocaine.
Shanghai Scream nuts. Drug infested, dealers showing up. I don't know the name of the dealers that showed up, because I think everybody was a dealer at that point, because the Scream being in downtown LA, the Surplus was there. Everybody was a dealer. Everybody walked around. Everybody was high. Every single person.
Because it was the bridge between punk rock and rock and roll. It was like they would play in the dance room, they'd play an old Bowie song, a T-Rex song, a Motley Crue song, a Velvet Underground song. It was like, and everybody there knew all these bands.
That was the first hangout that we were going to that was not like the Roxy Rainbow or Troubadour. It was like the first like weekly club. It'd be once a week, and then started twice a week, and just, it was a cool place to meet girls and stuff back there.
Scream was really cool because it wasn't just one kind of group of people. It was all where all the different genres, say, kind of mingled together.
I remember sneaking into Scream when Scream was in downtown LA, in that big warehouse or that big vacant building, and Jane's Addiction played. And I had to sneak in. There were two skinny walls about this wide, and I scaled between the two buildings like this, down the sides of the buildings, just to get in to Scream, me and my friends. And we snuck in, and I remember it was totally worth it, seeing Jane's Addiction. I mean, it was awesome.
The underground scene downtown was less, that was a great movie. It was like Less Than Zero, and everyone partied like that. So it was a very social get together, drinking, partying, hey, let's all hang out together. It was that, I think, like I said, it was a weird reason why Scream got to be as big as it did.
Raji's was a rock and roll nightclub in Hollywood. Opened in the 1980s and early 1990s, it was located at the Hastings Hotel building at 6162 Hollywood Boulevard. It was one of the great sweaty, smoke-filled dives of rock. It featured performances by iconic bands such as Green Day, Guns N' Roses, Red Cross, Hole, Dream Syndicate, Tex and the Horseheads, The Miracle Workers, Social Distortion, The Mentors, G.G. Allin, The Nymphs, and Los Lobos, as well as out-of-town acts like Nirvana. In 1994, following the Northridge earthquake, which damaged the club, Raji's closed, and the Hastings Hotel building was eventually demolished.
Raji's was cool. Raji's was like the Cheers of Hollywood.
I mean, I remember being in there one night, Tool played, and they took out our entire PA and put their PA in, and all the ceiling tiles broke and fell in, and it was just, if anybody was filming that, they've got an amazing piece, because it was just like snowing almost.
all my favorite bands played there. The Hangmen always played there. Tex and the Horseheads played there. The Nymphs played there. Unbeknownst to me, Nirvana played. None of us really paid attention to them. And they would play there a few times, and then all of a sudden they exploded. Had we known it was Nirvana, had we known what was to come, we all would have paid attention. But we couldn't be bothered.
Raji's is probably the coolest, filthiest club that existed in LA. Meaning it was probably like our version of CBGB's. Like, the bathrooms were filthy, but the vibe was probably the coolest vibe of a lot of those clubs. The bands that they had playing were bands that went on to become super huge. Bands like Hole, Nirvana. It was like the birth of, probably the birth of grunge happened at Raji's.
I mean, that was the fun Hollywood, you know, that big, you know, the underground was like where you could go, and it's just like this, like, it was an actual scene, you know, and everybody knew each other, everybody hung out, and it was like, you know, cool music and underground. It wasn't like commercial bullshit where you're just trying to, like, be a rock star or make money or anything. We're just there to play music.
East Raji's was a big dump, but everybody went there, and I saw a lot of post-punk bands there that were really great, like the Humpers and the Joneses. And I saw the very first West Coast appearance, like just when they were about to get signed, of Rage Against the Machine there before they were like introduced to the public.
Hated it. The pole in the middle of the stage. Hated everything about that place.
I actually met Kim Fowley at Raji's. It was a big event in my life. I really, may he rest in peace. Kim Fowley's an important person. We had just played there, and he had come to see the band. I guess somebody told him he should check us out. And I asked him what he thought about the band. He went on this long, oh, great speed freak, transvestite, junkie rock, you know, just this long, just using just about every adjective he could think of. But it was positive. And it seemed like he liked the band, seemed excited.
The eastern end of the Hollywood District, which runs from Fairfax Avenue to Highland Avenue, became a popular underground destination for new wave, punk, glam, and cowpunk shopping in the early 1980s. Pioneered by adventurous mom-and-pop independent retailers, Melrose Avenue captured the global imagination as the birthplace of Southern California's new wave and punk cultures.
Where did people connect? They connected on the street. There's no cell phones. We were on the street. We were hanging out. We were, we were talking about music. We were listening to music. We were playing music. There was art openings, and there was a lot happening around that place.
And I think a lot of the fashion was born out of, you know, hand-me-down and lack of money, but still wanting to have an identity. You know, a lot of it was antagonistic. Fashion,
I mean, definitely there were a lot of designers that were zeroing in on it and making stuff available that somehow was kind of rock band affordable.
One of my first jobs in Hollywood was I worked at a freight forwarder after I did delivering liquor. I always had jobs with drivers and bosses. You can always get a job in LA if you know where had a driver on the streets. But I worked for an international freight forwarder, and we were on Melrose, I think, in Kirsten or Garden or somewhere around there, when it was just a sleepy little Jewish neighborhood town, the butcher, the deli, all the different places, and then flip open. And one by one, all the businesses got booted out, and they changed it, and it became the hip Melrose.
An important period in rock and roll,
musical history is always accompanied by an important period in fashion, and the two complement each other. I don't think bands get enough credit sometimes for, you know, affecting the influencing the fashion industry.
It's great when everything can congregate together in one little area so that, you know, all those like-minded people are there kind of exchanging ideas and stuff like that, because, you know, as a kid, 16, no internet, where else are you going to find that?
I managed the store, and our clientele was heavy on the rock and roll, because we got all our material from Johnson's on King's Road in London. So we had Alex Van Halen was in a lot, Brian Setzer, Stray Cats, Duran Duran used to show up a lot. Who else did we have in? The Cult. They're big fans of some of the things that we carried, boots and stuff like
that. I landed a job at Jet Rag. And Jet Rag was cool because it was like I got to go and pick the clothes downtown. And they were, you know, they knew everyone was like a musician or doing something kind of arty. So, you know, you got all the really groovy clothes for like your shows or whatever at first pick.
That was where we got our clothes, our records, make everything. And I just, you know, felt like I need to work over here.
Coming from Pennsylvania, like, I just didn't see crazy stuff. I hung out with, you know, there was a bunch of, grew up in the country, there's farmers and stuff. So for me to like land in Los Angeles, I hear Jane's Addiction, I go to Coconut Teaser, and then, you know, I get a job at Jet Rag, all in a very short period of time, and there's, like, people shooting dope in the bathroom at Jet Rag, and I was just like, whoa, like, my mind was blown, you know? But I loved every second of it. It's what I wanted. I wanted to be around some crazy shit, you know?
Besides the fact that you could drink at work, you could smoke cigarettes at work, you could do whatever, you didn't even have to work at work. You could make flyers and put them in people's bags at work. Like, you could promote your band and get drunk at work, and it was like being at a club during the day. Yeah. You could, and all of this, and you get paid.
Because we would go out every night, and we'd party, man. And then, so when we'd come into work, I would sleep under the cash register, and Stephanie would be up. We would take shifts sleeping. And so, and then when the boss would come in, she'd kick me, and I'd wake up real quick and pretend like I'm stocking rings in the shelf underneath.
In Hollywood, where we were on Melrose, there was only one other record store. It was called Aaron's. And they didn't specialize in the stuff that we were doing. We were only carrying records. We were really picky. We only carried stuff that we liked. If we didn't like a record, we wouldn't carry it. And we had a bad reputation because of that, because people would come in and go like, oh, do you have the Fear record? And we'd go like, no, they suck. They're horrible. We would never carry that shit in here. And people would like be, and we'd go like, and if you want that record, go to Woolworth's. You know, we would like kick people out of the store all the time. And we were really opinionated, and we only carried what we liked. And it was our store. We could do whatever we wanted, you know, so we did. That was our deal.
It was a lot of energy, you know. The clothing was a big part of it. Everybody would go shopping on Melrose, and my favorite part was they had the best British English Beatle boots that would come over, and you know that's what we all wore. And I swear I ruined my feet with those things. I could barely walk sometimes. My feet are deformed from wearing Beatle boots for 20 years.
It was just the place to be during the day. It was the club during the daytime. There were all these amazing stores, all these clothes you couldn't get in Houston, Texas, that's for sure, because I used to make my clothes from the Goodwill to try to look like the clothes I saw happening in LA.
And that was pretty much my college. I didn't really go to college.
Michael Jackson come in there with a little tissue tape to his Ray-Bans and stuff. Just, and that was weird, because I saw Michael Jackson when I was a kid. So that was pretty cool. He was nice. He just did a little pee. He didn't buy anything.
And you couldn't walk into the Sherman Oaks Fashion Square or into Sears and buy those jeans. The only place you could get those pants was at Let It Rock at that time.
A lot of kids hung out at our store. A lot of kids hung out on the street in front of our store. A lot of kids panhandled on our corner. A lot of kids went between us and Let It Rock and Retail Slut. There was like a scene. So kids would walk up and down Melrose. It was a big outdoor sidewalk scene going on. Izzy was one of those kids. He hung out at the store, and him and Tammy and all of these people would come in every week and ask what clubs we were doing and could they be on the guest list. So these people were like permanent guests. When Henry started doing Glam Slam, every week those were the people on his list because they had no money. They were panhandling.
In the daytime, I'd be doing Let It Rock. I worked there for about 8 years. And it was a good, fun job because if you were a musician, you spoke to the musicians who shopped at the store like one of their own. And it was fun to kibitz with people and talk about where they've been and where they're going and what was happening with the band and all that kind of thing. So it was quite a very cool job to have. Plus, we were a destination for all those bands. They all came to the store looking for something that they knew we had. Prince used to shop at the store. Bob Dylan showed up waiting for me to open the store one morning. We had Cher drop in. And Michael Jackson showed up one day to look at the bootstraps and the various gear that we carried like that. Shortly thereafter, he came out with an album cover, what was it, Bad, where he had all these straps all over him, so it's kind of funny.
Everyone that worked in stores looked phenomenal, like you'd never seen anything like it, like, look at that person with egg-whited hair, or just everyone looked unique. The music everyone was playing was stuff that you really hadn't heard before. The clothing was weird, it was its own little world. And it was really tight-knit with people that worked on the street at certain key stores. Like, we all knew each other. We all went out every single night. Probably most of us were rolling into work from venues, from gigs the night before. And it was great. It was an opportunity for people to actually have jobs and look how they looked.
Now it's just every single store is the same crap that's, like, made in China, that's just this ephemeral garbage, you know. I mean, I don't want to be a clothing snob, but if there's no lining, I'm not spending more than $30 on it, you know. And like, and the whole thing with, like, you know, they used to have all these record stores, they're all gone. I mean, it's kind of sad. I mean, now Melrose is sort of what Hollywood Boulevard was.
Yeah, Melrose, I mean, when we first started coming down to Hollywood, to LA, remember back then, Hollywood Boulevard wasn't what it is today. It was kind of just
dirty, scummy.
Yeah, it was tourist, a little tourist section during the day, and at night it was super sketchy. So Melrose was the spot to go shopping, first of all. It had the coolest stores. Poser was there. You had Let It Rock. You had stores that were carrying stuff from London. That's where we went to buy creepers, leather pants, you know, wristbands, and stuff like that. And it was cool. It's like somewhere where you could go all glam rocked out and strut down the street, and you'd bump into, you know, guys from other bands. We would go flyering there. You would see celebrities there. Bumped into Steven Tyler from Aerosmith one time. Was super excited.
Melrose was really happening when it had stores that were all individual and they all complemented each other. But once you had one store get big and all of a sudden there was four more stores the next year just like that store, selling the exact same stuff or knockoffs of that stuff, that's why I think Melrose kind of jumped the shark.
About Melrose, all I know is this. It was amazing. The rents were super cheap, so artists could afford to have really cool shops. The minute the streets started getting press, and Japanese started coming in, and there was editorial on the street, the landlords started raising all the rents, which drove all the artists out. The only people that could afford to rent shops were people with money and no taste. I mean, I don't know if anyone's been to Melrose lately. It pretty much sucks. And I've lived in the same spot above where Vinyl Fetish used to be for 30 years. And there was a time when I would tell people, I live on Melrose Avenue and it's amazing, because it was. But now when anyone asks me where I live, I tell them I live on Poinsettia Place.
You know, I think also pay to play had a really big part of it, because, you know,
when I've never paid to play anywhere in my life. I mean, I've definitely gotten ripped off and, you know, played shows for free, which I didn't expect to. But that really changed the dynamic. And I think that was something that became very prevalent in the late 80s.
When we did that one show at the Palace where Alice in Chains opened for us, I knew it was over. I knew right then it was over. It was so much better because they came out and they had these tiny little lamps with this huge fucking sound. And just the most wicked fucking dark sound I'd ever heard in my life.
You know, what do we got now that comes close to even just a level of sincerity? You know, everything just seems so polished and buttoned up. And it's not like, you know, oh, it's got to be rough or whatever. But, I mean, what happened to music? You know, it just used to say a lot more. And now it just, I don't know, it's just a bunch of beats and this and that. And it's all cool. It is what it is. It's just not my cup of tea.
Well, I think it's the cycle ended everything. I think, you know, people grew up. You know, I was, when I first started hanging out on the scene, it was, you know, it was a teenager. As your priorities change, the scene seems to change.
In a normal music scene, what happens? A bunch of musicians kind of get inspired by a couple, two or three points of light, and then it kind of coalesces. Then you get your people coming in from out of the scene. They go, this looks like something we can glom onto and maybe make something happen for ourselves, and it kind of gets bigger. And then every label decides they need a Jane's Addiction and they need a Guns N' Roses, and those first in line get, you know, your Broken Homes and your, you know, whoever else it would be.
There's probably a couple things that I wasn't very happy with. It's when I saw bands like Guns N' Roses coming down to Raji's to play. It didn't make any sense to me, you know? It's like, stay at the Roxy where you got a good PA and you've got, you know, a good light show and everything, and just leave this place to us, you know? So when I saw them play there with Paul Stanley and Gene Simmons walking through the, I'm just like, what the fuck? Why are you guys in my house?
By the time I stopped working there, it was done. That club scene was done because the whole grunge thing was starting. That was when I went to work at Slash Records, and pretty quickly, Sub Pop was exploding. Bands like Nirvana were coming onto the scene, and that, you know, black clothed kind of glam goth club scene was over.
It just fizzled, you know, like anything. It just started. The clubs had less and less people, and, you know, I remember the first night that came along where we didn't go out and do anything. We ended up staying home, and it was in the early 90s, like 92, and we were all just amazed that, yeah, we're not doing anything tonight. Can you believe it? Because I went out every night of the week for 5 years in a row. There was something to do every single night. And when that first time came along where we didn't do anything, we were kind of sat there dumbfounded. But then, you know, those nights, there'd be one a week, two a week, three a week, four a week, and before you knew it, we were sitting home every night.
Well, you know, I got married in 1990, and I, you know, the band broke up, and I was burned out on it, and there was like a younger crowd coming in. So I think it was just, you know, torch passing time, really. And most of the good bands had gotten signed, and we had these lesser bands that were still getting signed, but weren't producing. And so there was just less and less interest in it, and people kind of graduate. Either they move on or they just become burnt.
People moved with the dream to Hollywood and didn't come with the toolbox, you know? And so it's like, you know, it became the Boulevard of Broken Dreams, and people stopped hanging out on the Strip. You know, and they outlawed posting flyers or handing out flyers, and so, you know, they'd fine you.
In my opinion, I felt it ended sort of, you know, this is the cliche thing to say, but for me, it kind of ended when Nirvana and Pearl Jam came out. It felt like that scene no longer existed to me. Like, when that happened, that felt like, oh, that's the new guard.
Everyone trying to get that record contract because they knew someone was gonna, because Guns N' Roses did, and some of these other bands they'd signed just to keep them out of the pool so Guns N' Roses could do well. But they didn't know that. Everyone thought they were gonna get signed and be made to be like Guns N' Roses. But we weren't, we would love to got signed to some record label. Yeah, that would have been great. But we couldn't, because we were just too lame. I mean, it's like, our guitars were never in tune, and we jumped around too much and were too weird, and we wore weird stuff that you couldn't really pigeonhole, and it didn't really go with what the kids were supposed to be wanting at
the
time.
We were doing a lot of drugs, but everybody was doing drugs. Everybody was doing the heavy shit, and it just seemed like, I don't know, at least in my group of friends, in my world, that kind of put things... And the bands that were my friends and stuff, that kind of took, you know, playing music and having that be the most important thing took a backseat to doing, to partying, you know, to doing a lot of drugs and stuff.
And we were playing in Pittsburgh, and these kids were like, oh, I can't wait to see you guys. And I was like, oh, great, great, great. So when are you going to come out with a new album? I'm like, the album came out like 2 months ago. And I knew right then, it's like, these are people that are fans that have no clue, like, that we even have a new album or anything.
I mean, I guess it all ended around 89. That seems like when all of it closed down. And I think probably, like a lot of things, I think probably Seattle is what closed a lot of it down. I mean, certainly it's what closed the hair metal bands down. They were out of a job. And then I think with Los Angeles, a lot of those bands had gotten signed, put their records out, either did something or didn't do something. And the Seattle scene was happening, and there were great bands, and it was kind of like, it wasn't, the torch was being passed, because we didn't pass it up to them or anything. Like, but, you know, it was like, Los Angeles had that little period, and now someone else is going to get that little period.
When you get one band that pops out of a scene and becomes wildly successful, where you're going to end up with is, you know, 50 bands following behind it, trying to do the exact same thing. And, you know, for a while, the industry was constantly looking for the next Guns N' Roses. I just do a little bit, I just kept trying to get a little bit. There were a lot of bands who thought they were or were pretending to be, but they, you know, many of those bands didn't really understand what Guns N' Roses was and how they were a mixture of hard rock and punk rock, and they did have underground sensibilities.
I don't think it really died. I mean, it just changed. I mean, there still is a scene now. It's just different. Like I said, I've been playing music since the 70s. Started out as a glitter scene, then it turned into a punk scene, but it was the same people. It was still Sylvain and Johnny Thunders and those people, and then I ended up in L.A., and at first it was punk, and you know, you had bands like the guys from Junkyard came out from Texas, and they were in a punk band in Texas, Big Boys, I think they were called. And now all of a sudden everybody's calling it hard rock and glam rock, and then, you know, we're doing garage, and then all of a sudden bands come in from Seattle, and it's okay, now it's grunge, and then now, you know, we're full circle again, and there's a garage rock scene again.
Scream held on at a couple of more locations. Every now and then a Helter Skelter popped up, and it took a lot of the gothic crowd away. I think things started to go a little bit more. You only went to the venue that played the kind of music you liked. I think it kind of got a little segregated for a while.
Maybe not so much in the United States anymore, or maybe we're getting a little bit older. I mean, I'm sure there's scenes out there where there's kids are running out to go see this band or this DJ or whatever. I'm sure it's happening. But I do think that maybe with technology, you know, people have everything right here. They're not as compelled to go out as they were back then.
Okay, when you're involved in something like that and things are going well, it's kind of like how gas prices went down for a minute and everybody went out and bought SUVs. Like, you know, that's it. Happy days are here again. Like, when you're in the middle of a scene like that and things are, and you're just, everything's looking better and better every day, the last thing you ever think of is that this is going to, the polar opposite's going to come and just annihilate all of you and whatever. The opposite of what you sound like and look like is going to be the biggest thing in the world. You can't imagine it. You can't see it coming. Like, You have stretch jeans and cowboy boots, and damn it, that's the way things are going to look forever. Like, but all you have to do is look back at history and see that everything is just, you know, has a cycle to it and lasts a certain amount of time, and that was our time. And like, when the Seattle thing hit, I remember I went to sleep and Skid Row was on MTV. And I woke up the next morning and it Smells Like Teen Spirit was on TV.
If that was to be today, it probably wouldn't work because, you know, these guys get together from who knows where and they get up and there's these bunch of guys creating a certain sound that just happens to click for that certain time.
I think it was over when you could open up a band magazine and cut all the bands that had different ads in there. Every single band looked exactly the same. There was no uniqueness to it. They just looked like they went to metal glam factory and they got stamped and that was that. And that to me was the death of the scene in LA.
The death of it was kind of a good thing because it affected music as a whole. And I think that what Perry did with Lollapalooza was actually showcase so much diversity. Like I said, Nine Inch Nails, the first time I ever saw Nine Inch Nails was there. Now, I'm into Nine Inch Nails now, you know, and like now I'm discovering industrial music and that's a whole thing.
It's almost like the scene eats itself. Every good scene around the world will run its course and it almost becomes a parody of itself where people who are pushing it aren't really, like you said, not really into it. It's almost like their heart's not into it or there's some tag-along people that are just kind of capitalizing on the scene.
The bummer, I think, was the timing that the Hangman's record came out in. Our record came out 6 months too late. Hangman's record came out 9 months too late. Broken Home's record came out way too early. Broken Homes to me, were way better than the Black Crowes ever could have been.
Later on, it became like really, okay, we got to be signed and we got to be rock stars and, you know, and it moved over to the other side of town, which the Whiskey and the Roxy and the Troubadour. And so over and over again, we were like, we'd all have like once a month, we'd have our big show at either the Troubadour or the, and we'd rotate around those three clubs. And those are the clubs where we thought we were gonna like, what's gonna make us rock stars. And that was the goal, to be a rock star. It was never really my goal. I was kind of going along with it, but it really my goal was to, you know, express myself.
Well, the end for me of the community and the vibe and the scene, when it started, when all those bands like Warrant and all the wannabe Warrants and all those other people started coming in. I mean, I felt like there were Greyhound buses parking on Sunset Boulevard, letting off, you know, all these musicians from other states trying to do the same exact thing. And it just got, it was just so awful at that point that when Nirvana came and grunge came and just killed everything, it was like, for me, it was like, thank God.
It used to be where there were these tribes of people that had a look that followed a certain kind of music and would go out to clubs to hear that and be around people that were also in that tribe, whatever tribe it was. Whether it was rockabilly or psychobilly or goth or mod, or it doesn't seem like that's a thing anymore. It just doesn't seem that way to me. I mean, I could be wrong because I don't go out that much anymore, but I don't know, it seemed really exciting back then to me.
The 80s ended with the advent of AIDS because everybody suddenly was scared that the next person you slept with may be the person who kills you.
I think also a lot of people started being so much more concerned about whether or not they were going to get signed and who was signed and, you know, who was getting what and who was doing what. When that started happening, it became kind of no fun for me, you know. I think that's one of the reasons I quit music was I was never interested in the business side of it.
Nothing stays the same in Los Angeles.
nothing. I mean, you just have to grab it and enjoy it for the moment that it's alive. And then when it's gone, it's gone. And it was gone.
After leaving the Hollywood rock and roll machine, I got more back to who I was. I got back to being real. I stopped wearing all black. I stopped putting white powder on my face. I stopped dyeing my hair black. And, you know, I mean, that was really like, it was a fun, playful phase of life. But it was, you know, I was a kid. And then I grew up.